welcome to A Talk With. I'm Mark Crosby. Thank you for joining us. We are in the Quincy Access Television studios. We are talking with Senator John Keenan, who got back not too long ago from a trip to Greece, a refugee camp in Greece. We'll learn all about that, his experiences there, during this half-hour program. So, John, welcome.
Great, thank you. Thanks for having me, Mark.
Great to have you here. Quite an experience to visit a refugee camp. How long were you there?
I was there just short of 3 weeks. I left on Christmas Day and came back in mid-January, I think on the 14th of January. So just short of 3 weeks.
And I really think with everything that's going on in the world, with the migration of folks, especially when we look at the U.S. from Central America, we're looking at the border of Mexico and the United States. This is a topic, it's a hot topic, it's certainly something that is very present now, but it really has always been present.
In modern times, post-World War II was a period when there was enormous refugee crisis, and the countries of the world came together and addressed that. They have been flare-ups, so to speak, over the many years, and more recently it seems that the problems in different parts of the world are creating more refugees, and we're at numbers now that rival those following World War II, and we have to find a way as a world community to figure this out.
Well, I think it's maybe because of the current administration. I think it's maybe on the minds of folks more often here in the U.S. than it maybe has been.
Yes. Yeah, there's it's very interesting the way it's presented here in the United States. It's more of an illegal immigrant presentation as opposed to refugees seeking asylum. And there's a very big difference between the two. People have a right under international law to seek asylum if they're fleeing dangerous conditions or their personal safety is in any way threatened. They have a right to seek asylum, basically to go knock on the door of a country and ask for admission, to be admitted because of the situations. And then there's a process related to asylum. Illegal immigration is something different.
I'm glad that you differentiated the two because unfortunately they tend to get, in today's state, they tend to get grouped into one.
Right, yeah, and there is a distinction. And whether it's on the southern border of the U.S. or over the area of the world where I was and in other areas as well, there are people who are fleeing very dangerous, hostile situations and have no choice but to pack up their families and try to find a place that is safe. And again, under international law, they're allowed to do that, and they go through the process. We're going to have the problem as long as there's conflict and war, and increasingly so as a result of some of the natural catastrophes and natural disasters that we see in different areas of the world, because they strike. States, countries are not able to handle the response to those, and so you have people living in very inhumane situations, and so they're forced to move.
We'll talk about this because let's briefly talk about the economy in Greece, and we will get to the conditions in these camps, but clearly there's a relation between the two.
Sure, it's impacted Greece's ability to respond. Back in 2015, 57% of the arrivals in Greece were through the small island of Lesbos, which is about 8 to 10 kilometers off the coast of Turkey. And so people fleeing war in Syria and Afghanistan would make the trek through the mountains to the coast with smugglers and then pay smugglers to, they're supposed to transport them across to Lesbos, and we can maybe touch on that a little bit. But so that was the path that they took. And so Lesbos is an island of about 88,000 people. It's a pretty good sized island, but 88,000 people, so not that much smaller than the city of Quincy. And imagine in a month, 135,000 people coming ashore here in the city of Quincy seeking refuge. And so you have this island of Lesbos, 88,000 people, in a struggling economy, much like the rest of Greece, and all of a sudden you have people literally washing up on your shore in really tough shape because of the trip that they have gone on. So they're presented with a very difficult problem. We met with the people of Moria, the town. The head of the town is called the president, and he explained it along the lines that we opened our arms, they were guests. We welcomed them into our homes, into our community. They said, but we found that we just weren't equipped to handle as many that were here. And he said, so now we're struggling with how to do that. And the Greece, government of Greece is also struggling with how to do it, and the European Union and the world is struggling with how to address these situations.
So let's talk about how you made this trip. What made you decide how it was available to you?
I became aware of it through a program over at the Harvard Kennedy School, and it was called the Harvard Greece Humanitarian Learning Journey. And so when I saw it, I had to apply and to pay for it and go through all that process. And in doing that, we had to write an essay, fill out an application as to why we felt we could contribute something. One, I had mental health and substance use background, but particularly mental health they thought would be helpful. And two, I just view this as a problem that is one of the major problems in the world, and how could I pass up the opportunity to, one, go witness it, and two, to see if I could offer in some way some assistance.
Because bottom line, people are people, whether they're here, whether they're in another country, we're all the same.
I came back with that idea first and foremost in my mind. We're all the same. People value the same things. They value their family, they value their community, and it's universal that people want work because work makes them feel good. And that's so true in the camp that I was in and the situations that I saw.
And we all see the same sky too, and,
yes.
And conditions. I know in your blog, I read about you comparing a sunset, which seemed gorgeous, to then the conditions in the camp, which just seemed so off.
Yeah, some of that was just so stark. It was kind of surreal. Walking through the camp, you would see a family walking arm in arm with a couple children, and you thought, oh, that's nice. It's almost like they're out for a Sunday walk. It might have been a nice day. And then you realize they're going back to this tent that's on a hillside or in the camp itself that has sporadic electricity, no running water, heat that's reliant upon the sporadic electricity. And so one moment you're thinking it's like a Sunday walk, and then you realize, but look at the surroundings. And I found that too, going into the camp, and I have a photo of it. I guess we'll go through the photos in a moment, but going into the camp, it reminded me of a prison and a playground, and yet it's neither. It's not a prison, they're not criminals, and it's not a schoolyard or a playground, because they're not going home to a warm meal or to a warm home. They're living right there and in the midst of all that mess.
We do have, as you had mentioned, photos that will kind of provide a chronological journey of your time spent there, and those will be on screen momentarily. Or we can certainly call up the first one.
Sure, maybe if we call up the first one. The first one is a beautiful picture. It's of a small village on the coast of Lesvos, and that's how it looked when we were there. And back in 2015, there were literally tens of thousands of people coming into this very small village on a monthly basis. And the people of the village were rushing to find food, to find blankets. The Coast Guard, the Greek Navy, was bringing them into this area. And it was hard to reconcile looking at the village as we were there with everything that had occurred there over the course of many months.
And we should mention that in 2015, a body of a young child actually washed up.
Yeah, 3-year-old Alan Curdy, a young Syrian boy, and washed up on the shores of Lesbos. I was on a different island, but washed up on the shores of Greece. And he died, he drowned, as did his 5-year-old brother and 12 other people that day. The picture of him made it to the Time magazine, I believe, and it became kind of an iconic picture. And it brought some attention to what was going on over there. And I don't have that picture because some people find it very hard to look at. But so that happened on a beach, and then you had people who were out in the waters that were being pulled ashore by the Coast Guard and the Navy. What happens, so they come into this village, and they were given some care. But in the crossing, many of them went overboard. They would pay smugglers to transport them the 8 to 10 kilometers across the water. Those smugglers would give them life jackets, charge them for the life jackets, and put them on boats. They would, the smugglers would provide somebody to kind of captain the boat across, particularly a raft. And then about halfway across, a boat would come along and take the captains off and leave the refugees to fend for themselves in this tough crossing. And many went overboard, many of the boats capsized, and the life jackets that they were wearing weren't really life jackets. And we have a picture, the next picture you can show, it's called Life Jacket Graveyard. And that's a picture of the life jackets that were taken off the shores of Lesbos and removed to this area. And as you look at them, you'll see written on some of them that not to be used as a flotation device. And people paid for these thinking that they would save their lives, and they didn't. So many people came ashore at Lesbos. They were welcomed into community, and then they were brought to Moria Camp, which is a refugee camp that had been a military installation, and it was now to be used as a processing facility, designed to hold 2,000 to 3,000 people. And at one point in the camp itself, there was about 10,000 people. And as the people get to that location, with all the trauma that they experienced trying to get to Europe and away from the horrendous, horrific situations in their home countries, they come and they see, there's a picture here of razor wire. And that's their first...
Not very inviting.
Not very inviting. And that has become a real political issue as to whether that razor wire could be taken down. And it hasn't been in the few years now that the camp has been open. So there's a picture there, and that shows the contrast too. That was a beautiful night. That was one of the first nights that we were there. And I saw the beautiful sky and saw the razor wire, and I thought, what a contrast. And that wire there in particular is outside the area where they would go for processing. Each morning, people just swarm to this area to push and shove, to get in line, to try to get to the point where they can have their asylum claims, the start of the processing of them. And then the next picture is, it shows some razor wire within the camp. So this is within Moria Camp itself. And that actually is a pretty neat corridor. Many of them aren't so neat. But again, it gives the impression that these people are imprisoned. And they're free to come and go.
It's very stark.
It's very stark. They're free to come and go from the camp into the community, and yet this is how they live. And you'll see on the left there, there's a number 1774, it looks like. That's the number of a tent that is within the camp. So people lived in these tents in the camp or in these kind of container boxes. They call them ISO boxes. And it's very cold. When we were there, it was in the 30s. And in fact, one time it snowed. And in the winter, it's very, very hot. And so they have to adjust to those extremes while living in these conditions.
Now, you experienced a lot of rain while you were there.
A lot of rain while I was there. It was very raw. Maybe a couple days where we had sunshine, but it was a rainy season.
And I think you had said in your blog that most had sandals.
Most had sandals.
Or wet sneakers, whatever they
wet
had.
Wet sneakers, Crocs, sandals,
dry.
Whatever people had donated is what they had on their feet. When at one point, and I'll show the picture, when we were kind of delivering some things to some of the residents, a little boy came up and wanted to help, and his lip was quivering from the cold. So it's really interesting to see the contrast. And then there's a picture of, just to kind of give you a sense of the camp again, of an outside wash area. So on one of the pathways, they have, that's where people go. They do everything there, whether it's washing their clothes, washing pans. That's kind of a long one against the wall. And then the next picture shows an area that's inside, an inside wash area. And not really somewhere where you'd want to wash pans or clothing.
Looks like a prison cell.
It looks an awful lot like a prison cell. And but that's where people live. And the conditions in Moria Camp, which is on a hillside, and the pictures that we just saw were such of condition and overcrowding that people found it preferable to move out of the camp onto a hillside next door called Olive Grove and to live literally on a hill in a tent rather than live in the camp. And the next picture is a picture that shows a gate and some young boys. That's over in the Olive Grove, and that's what they do. They kind of mill around all day. Kids are kids. They still smile and laugh and play. At one point, I was walking down a hill, and I saw a bunch of kids around a puddle, and I went up and said, what are you doing? And one of them spoke English, and he said, we're fishing. And I looked at the puddle, and it's just all kinds of debris and garbage. But the kids were still smiling. To them, they were fishing, as kids, you know, like to pretend.
Right, and I think certainly make the best of a given situation and maybe try to see the fun
right.
in a situation that isn't so much fun.
Right. And the kids end up being pretty resilient.
I was going to say, do they adapt better than the parents?
They adapt, and a lot of the studies show that the impacts on young children, if they get care and attention at the right stage after experiencing this, are somewhat less than it might be for an adult or an older adult. The unaccompanied minors, those that are teenagers, for instance, without parents, they struggle a great deal. There's a lot of incidents of cutting. They will cut themselves, one, to get attention, but more so to just deal with, that's how they deal with pain and the stress of the situation. Some of them will cut and peel the skin, if you can believe that. And so it's very difficult for them, and they live within a concentrated area within Moria Camp. Some will say that they're older to avoid having to live in that area. And I came across a young man who, that was his situation. He said he was older than what he was because he just didn't want to live in that part of the camp.
Now, folks you had talked to, obviously they were leaving a bad situation, coming into a not so great situation, but were they thankful that they arrived somewhere where there wasn't the violence that they had in their country?
Yes, they were thankful, they were hopeful, but many of them, after many months of being in the camp, found that optimism challenged.
Right.
And some of them do okay with it, and others you just don't see. They're in their tents all day, struggling with depression or whatever the case may be. But yeah, it's very difficult. They arrive with a great sense of, okay, we've survived, and things are going to get better, and we'll make our way into the European Union, one of the European Union countries, and maybe meet up with family members. And then they get stuck here. And we met with the UN High Commission, and they admit that people are stuck here. The next picture they have kind of shows you why you'd find it difficult to live there. It's a picture of the olive grove, which is the area adjacent to the camp, private property that people have just kind of moved on to. And that kind of shows you what it's like.
There are no walls.
There are no walls. Tents are put together. There may be, in a tent, five or six people living. And you know, that looks messy there because sometimes people are told you're moving tomorrow. And so they take this few belongings and off they go, and somebody else comes in and tries to take over the spot. So, and that's, honestly, that's a pretty good picture of it. You know, there's other pictures, in particular, you have pictures with children in these surroundings, and it just breaks your heart.
And what about the concern of illness?
Medical attention is tough to come by. They try. There are a lot of non-profits, NGOs that are over there providing services, but there aren't enough. And then, for instance, with mental health issues, there was one psychiatrist, and the psychiatrist, for the whole island, for the residents and the people in the camp, and that psychiatrist was no longer offering services there. So people struggle with their mental health issues all on their own, which leads to violence, which leads to young children cutting themselves and acting out. There's not enough medical care being provided, despite the best intentions of some incredible people.
And your experience with mental health issues on Beacon Hill and mental health legislation certainly put you in a good position to at least understand as much as you can the situation that you were experiencing.
Right. So there was four of us who kind of made up the mental health team, and we were asked to come up with recommendations. One of the recommendations that we came up with was a mental health emergency first aid, just giving people the opportunity to talk to somebody who has some sort of training about what they went through, what they were experiencing, and to try to, you know, offer them, you know, some assistance, knowing that there's not a lot down the road for them in terms of continued mental health care. So that was one of the suggestions. And the other was that there's different organizations offering different services. Psychosocial services are a big part of mental health, athletic programs, painting programs. So different organizations were doing that, but nobody had a sense, it seemed to me, as to who was doing what and what
coordination was a problem.
Coordination was a big problem, and they weren't reaching as many people as they could. So we made a proposal that they map out what's being provided, that they do an assessment of what's needed, and that they can put the two together to come up with a more comprehensive approach to providing mental health services, as limited as they are to people in the camp and in Olive Grove. This is a day that we were delivering long underwear to people in the camp, and you can see the ground is muddy. It was probably mid to high 30s, pouring rain at times, and we were going around giving people long underwear that had been donated.
But men and women only.
Men and women only. That was the extent of that particular donation. And what struck me about that is people weren't trying to get more than what they deserved. You went to a tent and you'd say, how many people? And they would show you the papers as to how many people, or they would make a point of it themselves to say, okay, here are the four people that are living here. And they'd call out the people, and so they'd say, we have just four. They weren't saying, can you give us eight? Can you give us 10? They just were asking for what they, presenting to us the number of people that live there and asking for nothing more. And it was really striking, because you would expect people, oh, maybe I can get a couple extra pairs, maybe I can get a small pair and have my children wear it. They were just very respectful, very appreciative of, in this case, the long underwear being provided. It's the same with coats and other things.
During the time that you were there, did you find someone that had been there for years? Did you find people that had been there for months?
Months, approaching a year, and some of them understanding that they may be there longer. So it really runs the range. And they have what they call a vulnerability assessment that may move them up the on a list of priorities to be moved out of
processing.
The camp. Processing. And there's another camp just about a mile away called Caratepe, which is run by a municipality, and it's well run. And the organization that we worked with has a big role in operating that camp. And so it's a much better environment. They have a lot more communal aspects to the camp. And when you walk in, it's cleaner, it's neater. There's areas where people can gather for tea. There's mobile kitchen. We cooked in the mobile kitchen for people. So it's much better run. This was of a mother and son that on the day that we were delivering long underwear, I was walking up the hill. It was pouring rain. It was in the 30s. And I saw this beautiful young woman and baby peeking out of the tent. And one of my colleagues saw the same thing, so we went over, and my colleague asked, do you mind if we take a picture? And the mother was so proud of her little boy that she said yes, and that's the picture that I took. And
do you know how long she had been
I don't.
Camp?
You know, she didn't speak English. But it's interesting because on that very day, my nephew's daughter was being christened here at home, and I thought she was in her christening gown, surrounded by family in a warm environment, and this little baby's probably the same age in a camp in 35 degree temperature in pouring rain on a hillside. And you know, life isn't always fair. And that's what struck me that day. That picture, I have a picture of that picture in my office. The next picture is of a tent. It's a tent tunnel, and that kind of gives you an idea of what the living conditions look like. There's tents on both sides. That's how close people live. Within that picture, there may be a dozen people living in those two tents.
So, which leads me to ask, how does everyone get along?
They get along pretty well for the most part. There are issues between the different races, ethnicities, and religions that pop up, as you would expect people living in such close quarters, where they have to stand in line for a long time to get food, in some cases stand in line to use a bathroom, stand in line to take a shower, stand in line to get even to the front so that they can start the process of asylum. So you would expect that there'd be some conflict, and there is, and it's particularly difficult at night. And there are people who are drinking the camp as a result of their mental health conditions. There's young people who are sniffing glue, anything they can do to escape
the reality
of what they were dealing with. The other thing we did was, when we were there, we did go over to Athens for a couple days of meetings, and we met with the UN High Commissioner of Refugees, we met with UNICEF, we went to the Turkish ambassador's residence and met with the Turkish ambassador, one to discuss what we were seeing and experiencing and what their plans were. So we got a good sense from the Turkish ambassador of the big picture of the agreement that had been reached between Turkey and the European Union on how to deal with stemming the flow of refugees to Greece. And then we met with the UN Commission on High Commission on Refugees, and I have a picture there. We met with them, and we asked them, you know, what do you think about the conditions? And they hadn't been to the camp in quite some time. And their take was that the Greek government is not hostile to refugees. They're welcoming of refugees. They have a process in place. They have a strong legal system. So we're going to allow them to do it. And at this point, you'll see that I'm talking. That's when I raised the question, that's great. We know they're trying hard. But when does somebody raise their hand and say, it's not going well?
Right.
It's not working. There's a lack of political will. And being in the business I'm in, I understand political will at every level. And at some point, somebody has to say, yeah, there's politics to this, and we can't make the camp too attractive because it will draw more people, and all of those types of things. And Greek economy is in terrible shape, so how can we give more money to programs for refugees? The European Union doesn't want to accept people in some of their countries, all of that. But at some point, somebody's got to raise their hand and say, somebody's got to help these people. They're in desperate situations. So I'm hopeful. And I'm hopeful mainly because there's people who are willing to do good things. The group that I travel with, and we have a group picture, those are people that were on the trip and also people that worked with the nonprofit, the NGO that we kind of partnered with over there. There in this group, there are public health people, education people, military people, all coming together. And in the middle, there's a gentleman kind of set back. He's kneeling between kind of the front row and the back row. His name is Adil. He's the gentleman that started this organization called Movement on the Ground. And he came to Lesbos as a result of seeing that picture of the boy who washed up on the beach. And he started this organization called Movement on the Ground. And they're focusing in Moria mostly on the olive grove. And what they're doing is pretty remarkable. And I get updates pretty much every day through Instagram. And to see the progress that's being made, it's very impressive. And the organization is really doing really good things. So it's called Movement on the Ground, phenomenal organization, and we were so fortunate to partner with them. And then the last picture is a picture. This is something that the residents built over the entrance to the Olive Grove camp, Safe Passage. You look at that and you realize these people don't have much, and they just want to get somewhere safe. And they are full of spirit. I that's the thing that I walked away with that I just never expected.
You caught a few soccer games, did you?
Yeah, we played in a soccer game.
Right, okay.
We cooked, and we were cooking in this small kitchen. And all of a sudden, they'd break out in song and in dance. It was New Year's Eve, and they would just broke out in song and in dance. Anytime that we prepared a food or we ate with them, they insisted that we eat first. They are out helping improve the camp. And I do recognize those are the ones that we saw that were outside. And for everyone that was maybe outside and dealing with it, there was people in camps that were having real difficulty dealing with it.
Sure.
But the resilience and the spirit of these people, and some of the doctors, their computer code writers, accountants, from all walks of life, in this terrible, horrific situation. And it went, you know, before we went, there were articles written basically saying it was the worst refugee camp in the world. One of them was entitled Better to Drown, a Greek refugee camp's epidemic of misery. So that's where they live. And their spirit is just incredible. We went to a restaurant called Home for All that provides meals to refugees every night. And you go and they sing and they dance and you just say, how do they do this?
How do they find?
Yeah, and I found it very emotional seeing them so happy. But I guess it's how they get through the day. And it goes back to how we kind of started this. We're all human. We all live on this earth. We all are brothers and sisters in some way. And we have an obligation, a moral obligation to each other, to not let these things happen. We have to overcome the lack of political will and find a way to respect the dignity of people, to provide them with safety, and to provide them with opportunity. When you do that, the return is so great, from a smile to giving people opportunities. Just to close with a quick story, two young boys were coming across. We were making the crossing from Turkey to Lesbos, and they lost family members. And they made a pledge to themselves that day that they would be brothers. And they ended up at Moria. And they made their way through using street smarts and their educational background. And they now live in Mytilene, which is a city on Lesbos. So we met them for dinner one night, and they told their story. And their personalities just lit up the room. And after dinner, they invited a few of us over to their apartment. And we walked about a block from the restaurant down this little alleyway to this home. And they had the door wrapped like a Christmas present. And you went inside, they had stockings on the wall, they had a Christmas tree. These two young men were just doing, you know, incredible things, and they were so anxious to share what little they had with us. They made homemade desserts for us. And I look at their story, and
if so you they made the transition.
They made the transition. The picture, we have a group picture, there's a guy in the picture called Big Ali. He's now working with Movement on the Ground and supervising projects. There was some young women from the Netherlands that were there. When you put that all together, and it's an incredible show of human spirit. And
so I guess my last question would be, as folks watch this, what would you like them to get out of this, out of your experience?
I'm trying to figure that out. I haven't quite come to terms with it. I guess I'd like them to recognize that the depiction that we have here in the United States of people who go to borders of other countries being criminals, rapists, and drug dealers. Yes, maybe that's, some people are that. But the vast, vast, vast majority are good people seeking a better life, fleeing situations that none of us would accept living in. And that's not the illegal immigrant part of it, although some people flee because of conditions and become illegal immigrants. But in the context of refugees, they are just people who have nowhere else to go. And everybody in the world should play a role in that. Here in the United States, we don't play much of a role. And we're in Syria. We're in the Middle East. We're not pure over there. And yet, in some respects, we go like this. And we've got to recognize
That's them. This is us.
This is us. And maybe that worked back in the 1700s when North America was perceived as a bit of an island, but the world is, in so many ways, a much smaller place these days, and we have an obligation to our fellow human beings to treat them with dignity and respect.
And I would imagine that you would encourage folks to get involved in organizations like the one you got involved in.
Yes, and financial contributions are always welcome. And I know this particular organization, Movement on the Ground, and you could go to their website against Movement on the Ground. They spend their money that they get very wisely. They don't get a lot. They don't have a lot of overhead. They don't have a lot of administrative costs. The money really goes into improving conditions in the camp. And so there's other organizations out there as well. As with anything, you always have to be careful where you donate. Be aware, donate, don't fall for the rhetoric that we often hear. Know that they're human beings and that they deserve opportunity.
Just chatting with you for this half hour, realize the effect that has had on you.
It was an incredible experience, and I'm thankful for it. I just don't know how to use it best, and I'm going to work on that.
I want to thank you for watching. This has been a program of Quincy Access Television. Please continue to watch QATV for more locally produced programming.